Hi, welcome to the session on corporate finance. In the previous session, we were discussing about financial instruments. Financial instruments include bonds, the equity, shares, preference, and common. Then we'll discuss about contracts, forward contracts, future contracts, swaps, options, call option, put option. We'll discuss derivatives as well. Today we are in session 2, second topic on financial instrument. We had a discussion on the financial instruments, and we had a good discussion on bonds. Today we'll discuss about different types of bonds. Types of bonds. What are the different types of bonds issued by a corporate, on which what advantages the corporate will get and the investor will get? Debenture bonds. Debentures or debenture bonds are same, on which no asset is given as collateral. See, when you are not giving, when a corporate is not giving any asset as a collateral, obviously the bond which is issued by the corporate will be subject to risk. So attract these debenture bondholders, we may pay interest little higher as compared to the collateralized bonds. Suppose this is a bond on which the company, corporate company, land is given as collateral. In a sense, if the company goes into liquidation, these bondholders will be paid by selling the land of the company. The land is notarized in the name of the bonds, say 10,000 bonds of $100 each. So $1 million equivalent to that land will be notarized in the name of bonds. So each and in every bondholder of this 10,000 will have lien on this asset. Lien means right. Right on this asset. So they are fully secured. These bondholders are fully secured. But here the rate of interest may be 6%, 5%, because security is there, no? Whereas in debenture bonds, no asset is given as security. It's a risky investment for the bondholders. That's the reason why the companies attract by paying more interest, which is called debenture bond. They are not backed by any support as collateral. Any special asset is not, you know, no special asset is given as security. Income bonds. On this type of bonds, the bondholders will be paid only when the company gets some appropriate income. So that will be mentioned at the time of issuing the bonds, that the company should get this much income to pay you all. So there is a condition. Unless the company gets appropriate income, the bondholders will not get any interest. It is not much attractive because purely the income on this type of bonds depends upon the amount of income owned by a company. Serial bonds. This is a special type of bond issued by a corporate. To have the flexibility in the case of redemption. So we mentioned that out of 10,000 bonds issuing today, say for example, in each year we will redeem some amount of bonds in 5 years period. So these bonds will be redeemed, say for example, 20% in year 1, 20% in year 2, 20% in year 3. See, 10,000 bonds of $100 each it is 1 million. Means you are paying back 200,000 at the end of first year. By paying interest on 1 million, you will repay the principal amount of 200,000. Yeah. Next year, you will pay interest on 800,000 and you will repay a principal amount of 200,000. It is same like EMIs, how you pay EMIs and the interest is to be paid only on the balance amount. A serial bond is a bond which matures over a period of time. The period of time will be mentioned in the bond, information. So the advantage of issuing the serial bonds is that you don't need to look for a large amount of cash at the end of the bond period. Say for example, bond is of 5 years. What did we discuss in previous session, that we are getting $1 million today? Simply we'll have to pay interest each year at the end of each year. Say for example, this is 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. You have to arrange this money only at the end of 5th year. It is an advantage that you don't need to worry about the repayment of cash during these years. You'll have to just pay interest of, say it is 6%. Now you pay only just 60,000. And in the 5th year, you'll have to pay 60,000 interest and $1 million bond amount. One way, it has the advantage that you can make use of these funds and become strong to pay this 1 million. The other way, it is disadvantage that it is a huge cash outflow in 5th year. And if the cash is not available, the company may become default. To avoid this, some companies issue serial bonds so that assuring that the bondholders will be paid some amount each year. Say for example, here in the case of serial bond, you will pay 60,000 and 200,000, a part of the principal amount. So 1 million amount you are receiving at the beginning of first year, you are repaying 200,000 along with interest. So next year, second year, you will have 800,000 only. 800,000. 800,000 times 6%. So your interest burden will also get reduced. 48,000 interest. Not only that, you will repay a principal amount of 200,000. So next balance, third year, is going to be only 600,000. So it goes on like this, and at the end of 5th year, say you have a principal repayment of only 200,000. That burden could also be reduced. Yeah. So this is an advantage of serial bonds. Junk bonds. See, when the investors invest in a company, they look for what is the rate of interest, what is the duration of the interest. Okay, what is the rate of interest, what is the duration of the interest, what is the face value of, what is the rate of interest, what is the duration of the bond, what is the face value of the bond. Not only this, they should also see that what is the strength of the company. The company is issuing bonds for 5 years, but will the company exist at the end of 5th year or not? That is important. Even if it exists until 5th year, will it be able to pay me back this $100? What maximum I get in 5 years? 6%, 6%, 6%, I will get $30, which is nothing as compared to the principal amount. Principal amount is more than 3 times of this interest what you get. What happens if the company fails to pay this amount? I'll lose principal amount after 5 years. So these companies will have to go for rating. The rating companies like Standard & Poor's, Moody's, Fitch, they verify the defaultness, the chances of default of the companies, that what amount of assets this company has. If it goes into liquidation, whether these bondholders will get full amount or not. Based on that, the rating company give rates like AAA, which means that the company is full strong and lots of assets to repay its liabilities. Under any circumstances, no investor will have surprise. You can close your eyes and invest here. So there, the companies may, because companies have got triple A rating from rating company, companies may issue bonds at only 4.5% or 5%. Why? Because you may be getting less interest, but you will be, your securities will be highly secured. There is no chance of becoming default of this $100. You will sure get $5 each year, as well as your principal amount back. Okay. Whereas the bonds which are not rated by the rating companies are called as junk bonds, means high risky bonds. Some companies invest in this type of companies also, like DDD. Rating is given as DDD. Okay, they are called as junk investments. Junk investments are risky. That's the reason why companies offer like 8%, 9% interest. See, if you compare this way. So, this is the reason why, say for example, an investor has an amount of $100,000. He may also invest some amount in this kind of bonds. Say if he invests in a fully secured bonds where there is no risk, he may get only 3%. To some extent, he wants to accept market risk wherein he will get 5%. Okay. In some, you know, the fixed deposits with the nationalized banks or government banks wherein he may get only 6%. Or 6.5%, but when he invests junk investments, he may get 9%. See, risk-free investment, risky investment, three times greater. So what he does is, some portion of this investment he may invest, say $20,000 in risk-free. Okay, here $15,000 may be in a little risky investment, $30,000 may be in a high risk investment, little high risk investments, 30,000, 45, 65. The remaining amount, this will take 40,000, 40, 15, okay, 55 plus 30, 85. The remaining 15,000 he may invest here. If he loses, he will lose only 15,000. So it is not that people do not invest in junk bonds, but to have the good return on the entire portfolio, they may invest sometimes in risky investments as well. Now let's discuss about the other type of bonds, convertible bonds. See, in the capital structure, we discussed that the capital is made up of bonds, preference shares and common shares. The total capital is made up of three components: bonds, preference shares, common shares. The ultimate owner of a company is common shareholder. Bondholders, preference shareholders may be paid off later, maybe 5 years, 10 years, but the common shareholder will be there lifelong. Any investor who buys the common shares, of course he may sell it to the other investor. At the end of the day, this investor will be there with the company lifelong, and this may be sold to the same investor. So let the investors change, no issues. But the share says that you are the owner of the company. If the company is growing, obviously these bondholders, preference shareholders may regret that, oh, we should have purchased common shares at that time. Because the company is growing. The company common share was $10, say 5 years ago. Bondholder was also a part of it by investing $100 at the time, because he doesn't want to take risk. He was so happy at 6%. And he knows that this $100 will be paid off and there will be no relationship after 5 years. from with the company. He invested here. The common shareholder, what the bondholder were observing, that he got $2 dividend at the end of first year. And at the end of the first year, it went, the share price went to 23. He received a dividend of $2 and the share price increase in the investment was, you know, to $23. Second year, he received again $6, same like last year. And this gentleman has got $3 as dividend. This 23 has become now 32. See the growth. Now he regrets that my $100 remains same even after 5 years. Third year, still the bondholder may get only 6. But here, dividend is 3.5. And the share price is gone to, say, 44. See, the asset value is increasing here. Asset value does not change here. Bond value does not change here. So he may regret that I should have invested in common shares. The same time, this 10 will become, say, 8. 8 becomes 6. He's a loser. Then bondholder will be happy. My $100 is safe. Yeah. So, he may think that given a chance, I am ready to become common shareholder to enjoy the growth in the future at least. In this case, whether he has a provision or not, yes, at the time of buying the bonds, he should see for a provision called convertible. So if the convertibility option is there on the bonds, tomorrow he may become common shareholder. That option should be there. So the title should be like 6%, 5 year, convertible bonds of like this. So this shows that the duration is 5 years, interest is 6%, and there is a provision that the bonds can be converted. Convertible bonds, 10,000 convertible bonds of $100 each. Means the bondholder has a right to become common shareholder. Not preference shareholder, please. Preference shareholder is also for time being. Not preference shareholder. Common shareholder has right to become, bondholder has right to become common shareholder. And from that day, you will get dividend, not interest. From that day, he will get dividend. The moment he becomes shareholder, he will become shareholder and he will get dividend. Okay. Mortgage bonds. This we already discussed, remember, in the initial stages, the bond and debenture. Mortgage bond means some asset of the company will be given as collateral. Say for example, the company has 1 million worth of, you know, property, real property. Like it can be a building property or, you know, the land, etc. 1 million worth of land. Company wants to raise a capital of say $600,000. $600,000. This $600,000 is raised with the help of bonds of $100 each. Bonds of $100 each. So, how many bonds are we issuing? 6,000 bonds. 6,000 bonds of $100 each, 600,000. And these bondholders are given some assurance against this land. Land of the company. Means this land is notarized in the name of the 6,000 bonds. Whoever buys the bonds of this company will have right on this asset. The company goes into liquidation. When the company goes into liquidation, the bondholder will have a right to share this amount here. and land if the company goes into liquidation. If the company goes into liquidation, the bondholder has right to confiscate this asset. The court also will interfere, sell this land and settle the amount of this bondholders. So the bondholders are fully secured. They are called as mortgage bonds. These bonds are called as mortgage bonds. But remember, again, mortgage is of two types. First mortgage or second mortgage. First mortgage, second mortgage. Here, this land is mortgaged first time to 6,000 bonds of $100 each. Clear? What is the security still left? 400,000, right? 1 million worth of land is given to 6,000 bondholders of $100 each, which is $600,000. $600,000 is the bond amount and the security given is 1 million. The excess security available here is, say, 400,000. That is 1 million minus 600,000 here. So, this extra security in future, say, for example, company wants some more money. In that case, this company issues some more bonds of, say, for example, 50,000 bonds of $100 each. No, 5,000 bonds of $100 each. What is the amount here? 500,000. But what is the security given? 400,000. They are called as second mortgage bonds. These bondholders will get their money after the settlement of the first mortgage bondholders. So we can say that these bondholders or the 5,000 bondholders are partly secured bondholders. They are not fully secured bondholders. They will be paid only upon clearing of the first mortgage bondholders' money. So mortgage bonds are of two types, first mortgage, second mortgage. When you see the benefit, the first mortgage bondholders may be paid less interest as compared to the second mortgage bondholders. That's the reason why we attract the people to invest in second mortgage bonds. Subordinated debentures. Subordinated debentures seem like, you know, the debenture bonds, like what we discussed. There will be no collateral security, only the people who invest in this kind of bonds will get high rate of interest. That's the only difference. Zero coupon bonds. You must have to listen to this and understand what exactly a zero coupon bond is. It is not issuing at a discount, but it is deep discount. Now let me tell you the common form of bond, how the companies settle. Say for example, a company sold some bonds of $100 each. So say if you are a bondholder, say for example, the bond period is 5 years, you are getting $6 at the end of first year, $6 at the end of second year, $6 third year, fourth year and fifth year, along with interest, you will get your bond money back in fifth year. Getting me? This bond is issued at the rate of 6% interest. Interest is also called as coupon rate. Interest rate, coupon rate, both are same. Interest rate, coupon rate, both are same. So besides paying interest each year, at the end of the fifth year, we are paying the principal amount back. Here, the title says, we are paying 6% bonds. 6%. Okay. So here we are paying $100 along with $6 each year. But in case of zero coupon bond, what do we understand now? This interest is zero. Means we are not going to pay any amount of interest here. Zero coupon, no? Zero. 0% interest. Who will invest if you invest $100 here? nothing will be paid for 4-5 years here, and at the end of 5th year you will be paid back $100. Nobody will invest. See, present value, future value, both are same. Why should we invest? In this case, what we do is, we issue this bond at a lesser price, say for example $72. It is a deep discount. Don't call it as discount, please. It is a deep discount. A discount usually like 98, 97. When you issue the bond at 98, 97, whose face value is $100, we can say discount of $2 or $3. But here it is deep discount. So now you are investing $72 to become a bondholder, and you'll be paid $100 straight away here. Nothing is paid during this years, first year, second year, third year, fourth year, and fifth year. Will be paid only full amount of $100. This is a benefit you as a bondholder will get, like by paying less amount, he'll become bondholder. For the company also, it's a good advantage. It's a good advantage that though we are getting less amount here, we don't have any interest burden here. 5 years, we'll enjoy interest-free loan. But only thing is that you have to pay extra $28, because remember you received $72, now you are paying $100, an extra amount of $28. This is called zero coupon bond. Very good advantage to the company, because you don't need to have any cash outflows during the year, only in the fourth year. Indexed bonds. Indexed bonds are the types of bonds wherein the income on these bonds will be based on the indices of a particular country, the index number, like in India, NSE, BSE. So Sensex and all, when it goes up, the bond interest will go up. When the stock, the index number goes down, the bond interest will also go down. So it is linked with some other measure. Okay, very few bondholders like to invest in this kind of, you know, bonds, because it is not related to a particular, you know, performance of the company, or it is not related to any fixed amount, like we pay 6% or 8% or something like that. But it is related, the interest rate is purely based on some other measure. This is a topic about the bonds, different types of bonds. We discussed different type of bonds, advantages, disadvantages. Then we'll discuss now about equity. As we discussed that the capital structure of a company consists of debt capital and equity capital. On debt capital, we pay interest. Companies pay interest. On equity capital, we pay dividend. This equity capital is of again two types: preference share capital, common share capital. Yeah. On preference share capital, we pay fixed dividend, that we let the shareholders know first that what amount of dividend we are going to pay. Whereas the common shareholders or the ultimate owners who will get dividend after the payment of interest, taxes, fixed dividend, the remaining amount is available to common shareholder. In your income statement, you have EBIT, operating profit, earnings before interest and taxes. Say this is 5 million. Interest paid to the bondholders, say 500,000. 4,500,000. This is EBT, earnings before tax. Pay tax, say at the rate of 40%. 40%. 1,800,000. What is left here? 2,700,000. This is a net income. from net income, we should pay fixed dividend to the preference shareholders. Now, appropriations, how this 2.7 million is adjusted. This is the net income. From net income, we are paying fixed amount, say preference share dividend. Calculated preference share dividend is 1.2 million. Pay 1.2 million fixed amount. The remaining amount is called as IACS, income available to common shareholders. IACS, income available to common shareholders. This amount is the property of common shareholder. More amount comes here, say it is 15 million, interest will remain same. Tax is based on this amount. Then net income, again from net income preference share amount remains same, so you'll get more here. Now it is not 5 million, it is 3.5 million. 3.5 million minus 500,000, amount is same. EBIT will get reduced, tax then it will be less amount, but preference share dividend will be 1.2 million. Here you may get 350,000 or 250,000. So whatever you get in IACS, that will be the property of common shareholders. Common shareholder may get more, common shareholder may get less. He is a loser, is a gainer. So this IACS divided by number of common shares. Say we have 1 million shares. 1 million shares. 1.5 million IACS. Income available to common shareholders divided by 1 million shares will give you an EPS of 1.5. So profit per common share is $1.5. This common shareholder may decide, or may pass a resolution that 40% of this amount we will take it as dividend. What is the amount? 1.5 million. Times 40%. Okay. So dividend is going to be how much? 600,000. 600,000 is the dividend, and 900,000 will be retained in the business. This is the overall, you know, the rights and distribution to debt capital, common shareholders, preference shareholders. Now let us discuss in detail that what are the advantages, what are the disadvantages, what are the rights of common shareholder and preference shareholders. Rights of common shareholder. As we discussed that the common shareholder is the ultimate owner of the business. Yeah, he has a right to participate in the management of the company. Yes, he can cast his vote to become a director, to elect a director of the company, or he himself can also become director of the company. Common shareholders have voting rights to participate in the company operations, to elect directors, to be elected as directors. And common shareholder has the right to ask for dividend, but not fixed dividend like preference shareholder. But if declared, of course, he has right to ask, the dividend to be paid. Preemptive rights. Unlike bondholders, preference shareholders, the common shareholders have certain rights to acquire the shares in the same percentage what he held so far. Say, for example, a company has 40,000 shares. Okay, one shareholder invested in 400 shares of this 40,000. Now the company is issuing 20,000 new shares. 40 plus 20. But at the moment, we have only 40,000 shares. We took permission from the government to issue further 20,000 for the expansion of the business. Company is growing. Company is growing. This shareholder is very happy who acquired 400 shares of this company. He wants these shares. In this case, he cannot be like a strange investor. No. He has right to buy the same percentage of the shares here. What is the percentage here? 50% of the shares, right? New shares are 50% of the existing shares. Likewise, he will get 50% shares and he will become a shareholder for 600 shares. 400 which are held by him already, and he has the right to buy new 200 shares in the same proportion. If it is 30%, 30% you'll get here. Okay, that's called preemptive right. Right to share in the distribution of residual assets. So when the company is liquidated, of course, this is a poor guy will get only peanuts at the end of the year, at the end of the liquidation. When the company is closed down forcibly because of not performing well, it is called as liquidation. When the company is liquidated, all the assets will be sold off. This amount will be used to pay the liabilities, debt like government dues, taxes, unpaid wages, unpaid utilities, etc., etc., etc. Then bondholders, then preference shareholders, then the residual amount, means the remaining amount, will be paid to common shareholder if any amount exists after the payment of all this. If any amount still exists, that would be paid to common shareholder. If he's so lucky, he will get some amount. The advantages of issuing the common stock to a corporate. Advantages include common stock. The CEO of the company can be very, very happy that he doesn't have any fixed obligation to pay to the common shareholder, like bonds, preference shares, etc. If we get sufficient income, then only we'll pay to the common shareholders. And one important point is that bonds, preference shares will get matured one fine day. On the day, we'll have to arrange huge amount to repay. But in case of common shares, if a common shareholder doesn't want to be the shareholder, of course he will go to the share market and sell it to someone else. But he'll not sell it to the company back. So company is not responsible for the payment of the final amount of the share. So you sell it to A sells to B sells to C, but nobody will sell back to company. No need to arrange any money for the shares, will never mature. And here, no interest payment, only dividend. No interest at all. Okay. And the next important point is that the company, by issuing the equity, we can be out of the debt to equity ratio, less debt equity ratio. That is called financial leverage. Remember, in the ratio analysis, we calculated a ratio called debt to equity, the relationship between debt and equity. And the formula was debt over equity. Having more equity, the ratio will go down. If the ratio is higher, it means that the company is facing financial risk. Company is highly financially leveraged by outside parties. When a corporate highly financially leveraged, company will not have rights. Company will not have proper rights to operate the business. So in that case, what happens is the company will have to listen to lots of covenants. That's the reason why companies like to have more equity than debt. So having common share capital in our company, we can reduce the debt to equity ratio. We can reduce the financial risk. And the advantage is that if the company is booming, enjoying the good amount of profits, company is highly successful, so the value of the stock will go up in the open market, in the secondary market. As I said in the previous session, now like this, it was $10, but after publishing our results and all the shareholders existing and potential are very, very happy with the company progress, the share price may go to $12. After 6 months, it may go to $17. After 2 years, it may go to $30. So the appreciation of value of common stock, there is a possibility because we have a secondary market. For common shares, we have a secondary market. What are the disadvantages of company issuing the common stock? There are certain disadvantages to the company point of view. We are discussing about company point of view. No? The disadvantages include they have control. Like bondholders, preference shareholders do not have control, but common shareholders will have control. Okay. Sometimes he may say no. Sometimes he may say yes. Okay. The shareholder may say yes, may say no. So being a shareholder, he has also right to ask, right to say yes or no. And while establishing a company, when you present a business plan to the government, we cannot issue entire amount of capital through common shares. So there is a limit that what is the authorized capital. Within that, you are supposed to issue. You cannot issue more shares to have more funds because government puts a restriction that you can only issue the shares to the extent you are authorized to issue. So when the company is formed, the authorized capital is also to be registered, and the company can issue only the shares within the authorized capacity. The highest risk as compared to bonds, preference shares, okay, common shares are high risky investments. Bonds, as we discussed, that bondholders are paid off in the case of liquidation before the preference shareholders are paid off. Okay, preference shareholders will be paid off before the common shareholders are paid off. So least preference is given to common shareholders, and bondholders, irrespective of the profit, they get their own interest on time. Preference shareholders, they get dividend. Okay, but common shareholders will get only when ISES is positive. ISES means income available to common shareholders. If that amount is positive, then only some amount may be distributed to common shareholder. Okay, so we can say from these features that common share capital is risky. Risk to the investor. So obviously you think that why don't we invest in bonds so that our amount is safe and irrespective of the profit of the company, we get 6%. Why don't you invest in preference shares? We are getting say 8% dividend, and that 8% will be paid without even having the relationship with the profit or loss of the company. So there's a definite dividend. So to raise the share capital, issuing the common share capital, it's very difficult. So you'll have to pay huge amounts to the investment bankers, underwriters. So it is costly issue. Cost of issuing the shares is higher than the cost of issuing the debt. There are investors to buy bonds of your company, but common shares, it is difficult. And common shareholders are accepting the risk. Obviously, they will expect good demand and growth of the company. So in the resolutions, in the company meetings, they may demand the CEO, the management, that we want more return. We want more return so that the share price will go up, so that dividend amount will go up. And here, one great disadvantage to the company is that you are issuing bonds, you are issuing preference shares, company is issuing common shares. On bonds, we are paying interest. The special point on bonds as compared to the shares is that this interest is tax deductible. Remember in the previous calculation, EBIT minus I. Having this interest deducted from EBIT, our tax burden is reduced because after paying interest, we get EBT, earnings before tax. And we are calculating on EBT, which is the net amount, which is net amount after the adjustment of interest. Less the EBT, less the tax burden. But dividends here to the paid to the preference shareholders and common shareholders are the amounts paid out of net income after the payment of tax. So dividends are not tax deductible here. Means they are paid after tax from the after tax profit. If they are allowed as a before tax amounts, would have paid this dividend, then on the remaining balance would have paid tax. That's a benefit to the company. But dividends are not tax deductible items. They are to be paid after tax, paid from after tax profits. That's a great disadvantage to the company. Now let us discuss about the futures, what we have in preference shares and common shares. What are the differences between preference shares and common shares? Any questions here up to now? Yeah, now let us see some common features between the preference shareholders and common shareholders. So preference shareholders and common shareholders are similar in the case of dividend payment. Dividend payment, of course, we have some fixed dividend that has to be paid to the preference shareholder, but it can be accumulated. Say, for example, we are paying 8% dividend on $100,000 of preference share capital. Okay, so each year we have to pay $8,000. So this year there is no cash available, so it can be accumulated with the $8,000 next year. This year also there is no cash, so it can be accumulated and will be paid along with the next year. 8,000 plus 8,000, 16,000 plus 8,000 of current year, accumulation of dividend. So in the case of bankruptcy, no need to pay. Means company is closed down. So both preference shareholders and common shareholders will not get any dividend. Okay. And one common feature again is that the dividends are paid off from after-tax profits in both the cases, preference share dividend as well as common share dividend. This is a disadvantage to the corporate. Why? Because if these amounts are being these amounts are allowed as a tax deductible expenses, would have deducted from before tax profit and then only you pay tax, but they are not allowed. They are the appropriations of the profits, so will be paid off only from the after tax profits. And here both will be paid paid off upon liquidation, but there is a slight difference that preference shareholders will be paid just prior to the payment of common shareholders. Common shareholders will be paid only after the payment of bondholders. So in the case of liquidation, we give first priority for the bondholders, second priority for the preference shareholders, and if still any amount left, that will be paid off to common shareholders. If the amount is not sufficient, common shareholders will get zero. If the amount is still not sufficient, the preference shareholders will get zero. So only bondholders will be paid off. Or maybe preference shareholders will be partially paid. Cumulative preferred dividends. That's why I explained to you that these preference shares have a special feature that in case of the shortage of cash in the company, the preference shareholders will get a dividend along with the prior year dividend. Say for example, this year there is no cash available, but we know the amount of dividend because preference shareholders by default will get some fixed dividend. That amount is to be calculated and transferred to next year. That will be accumulated. So the next year we'll have dividend for the next year as well as the prior year dividend. So these two amounts will be paid in the next year, but maximum period of 3 years it can be accumulated. The advantages and disadvantages of issuing the preference shares to a corporate. Now think from corporate point of view. The advantage is that the preference shareholders do not have any voting rights. So they do not participate in the management of the company. Yeah, that's an advantage. Like bondholders, preference shareholders also do not have any voting rights. The disadvantage is that irrespective of the profit of the company, we have to pay a committed dividend. The dividend is fixed. 8% means 8%, even if the profit is less or more. And at the same time, the dividend is to be paid from after-tax profit, not before-tax profit. So dividend on preferred stock is not tax deductible. And the preference dividend is to be paid even if there is a loss. Yeah. Now, how a share is valued? How a share is valued? When you value a share, you should first of all check that whether it is a preference share or a common share. An investor has his own opportunity. If not invested in preference shares, you would have invested somewhere. You would have invested somewhere, and what is his earning capacity? That is called his expected return. If not invested in preference shares, you would have invested this money somewhere else. What is the expected return of the investor for common shares as well as, you know, preference shares? If not invested here, have invested somewhere else. What is expecting? Okay, so based on that, we need to value the shares. For preference shares, whatever be the company status, company is enjoying lots of profits, but as we discussed, still we pay him only 8%. Still we pay him back his money what he invested. But in the case of common shareholders, it is not like that. After paying bonds, share or preference shares, the rest is common shareholders' money. And also this face value of the bond, common share, need not be same $100. It may go to $130, $230, $430. It goes on like that. So the growth is for only the common shareholder, but not preference shareholder. Okay. So now we are valuing a share with a zero growth. Zero growth means it is usually for preference shares, because there is no growth for preference shareholders, because they get fixed dividend, right? Fixed dividend. And the formula to calculate the value of a preference share equals to annual dividend divided by the investor's required rate of return. Say for example, an investor invested into preference shares of $100 each, and we are assuring that 8% dividend we are paying, irrespective of the profit. Whether the company has lots of profits or no profits or losses, still we'll have to pay 8% of $100. Now the investor has an opportunity. If not invested in preference shares, you'd have invested somewhere else, and there he is getting, for $100, he is getting, say for example, $5.4. A bank is paying him $5.4. What are we paying here? $8. Annual dividend, $8. What is the required rate of return of the investor? 5.4. Because he had an opportunity to get $5.4 for every $100 of investment. So 8 divided by 5.4 times 100. Will give you 148 dollars. You know what is this? It means that if $148 are invested outside at the rate of 5.4%, you would have got $8. But by investing only $100 in our company, we are paying him $8. this $8 return is equivalent to an investment of, you know, $148. Now let me, you know, show you the calculation. If $148 is invested in other company at the rate of 5.4%, what is the amount? 148 times 5.4% is 7.999 or 8%. Whereas he is so lucky investing in our company, we are straight away paying on $100, $8. 8% we are paying here. So outside $148 investment is equivalent to $100 investment in our company to get same amount. Now, as we know that preference shareholders do not have any growth in the dividend, that's the reason why we use formula fixed annual dividend divided by investors opportunity cost required rate of return. You can just, if you want to calculate into amounts, you can just multiply with 100. Now for common shareholders, there is a growth in the dividend. Like say for example, this year we are paying a dividend of $3 and we have promised a constant growth of say for example 5%. So if current dividend is $3, so the next year dividend when you calculate, it is going to be $3 plus 5% of $3. So there is a constant growth each year by 5% on current dividend. So it is going to be 3.15. This is the next year dividend. Here the growth rate is 5%. This is what the company promises, that we have a dividend growth rate of 5% constantly. Okay, if there is a constant growth dividend model, the formula will be different. For that you need to know what is the current dividend, what is the growth rate, and what is the investor's expected rate of return, say 6%. He has an opportunity to get 6% if invested outside. So please remember these three components in valuing a common share with a constant growth dividend model: current dividend, growth rate, constant growth rate, and investor's opportunity cost. Based on these three components, we can value a share. And remember, the constant growth dividend model is used for valuing common shares. Because for common shares only, we can, you know, assure the growth in the dividend. Preference shareholders, we do not assure anything. Why? Because we initially mentioned itself that you will pay paid only 8% irrespective of the profits of the company. Now, constant growth dividend model is used for valuing the common shares using the formula like next annual dividend that I just explained you, that if the current dividend is 3% or $3 with a constant growth dividend growth of 5%, next annual dividend is going to be 3% plus 5% of 3%. So it is going to be 3.15. So next annual dividend is going to be 3.15 divided by investors required rate of return. What is investors required rate of return? Say 4% minus growth rate. Now let me give you more. Now investors growth required rate of return is 8% minus growth rate. What is the growth rate here? 5%. So 3.15 divided by 8 minus 5. 3.15 divided by 3. 3.15 divided by 3 into 100 multiplied by 100 will give you 105. Or 10.5. 10.5. If the share price is $10, shareholder is still happy because it is an invest, it is a return which is equivalent to $10.5. Okay, but by investing only $10, he is getting equivalent to an investment value of $10.5. If it is less than that, he feels that he of no use investing in this company. Okay, say for example, the growth rate, the required rate of return is 10% here. 10%, it will be 5 and the value will go down below 10. So he feels that of no use, I'm getting 10% outside and this company is paying me very less. So better to sell off these shares. So it depends upon the investor's required rate of return, opportunity cost. Stock right. What are stock rights? The stockholders or shareholders will be given some rights to buy the shares of this company in future, which we discussed just now as preemptive rights. Preemptive right allows the investor, the existing shareholder, to buy the shares of the company in the same proportion to what he is having in the company shares. Like if he has 20% of the shares here, he will get 20% of the new issuance. Rights on. When rights on are issued to a particular shareholder, the shareholder will have right to buy newly issued stock. Same right or preemptive rights. But here, it is his own choice that he can wait for the due date to come. If he is interested, he will buy. Otherwise, he will just throw it off. Anyone who buys stock before the X rights will be the owner of the stock and record date will receive the rights. Okay. Before the X right dates. Okay. Anyone who buys after X right dates will not get any rights to buy the shares of the company. So there will be a X rights date. So the shareholders who buy before X right dates will be given extra rights in next coming year, like 3 years or 4 years, etc. Then he has right to buy the shares of the company. So that's called rights on. Rights on means at any time when the company issues the shares, this shareholder will have right to buy the shares of the company. So X rights date after, X right date before is very, very important. If you buy the shares after X right dates, you are not allowed to buy any shares of the company with the using the rights. First of all, you will not be given the rights. You'll have to buy from the open market. You have to buy from the open market by paying the premium, high amount of premium. So the people who buy with X rights, within the date with X rights, will have to use those rights within the given period. Say for example, 6 months. He has right to buy the shares within the 6 months period. If the shareholder who has rights doesn't act within 6 months, the date is expired, so the rights will also expire. Stock options, employee stock options or warrants. These are the options given to the employees for their recognition to buy the shares of the company during their period of employment. So there will be an exercise date. Exercise date is nothing but the action taken by the employee to execute these options to buy the shares. The warrants or employee stock options are different from stock rights. Why? In the case of stock rights, you'll have to wait for the date and you can buy, or else you can throw it off. That's at the end of the day, it's in your hand that you want to buy the shares, you can exercise it, otherwise you can leave it. But here, in the case of employee stock options, some number of shares or warrants will be given to you, options will be given to you, that definitely you will get those shares in your account. And that number doesn't have any proper meaning. Some amount equivalent to some amount options or warrants will be given. But in the case of, you know, X rights, the existing shareholder will be given some percentage. Like if you have 4,000 shares, you are allowed to buy 400 shares. Okay, that is 10%, 15%, 20%. So there is a meaningful calculation. But in the case of options and the warrants, we don't have such amount. Only some amount will be given equivalent to the options. Within that you can take. But in the case of stock rights, you have some proportions or, you know, the percentages. American depositary receipts, ADRs. American depositary receipts are nothing but these help US citizens to invest the share, the various investments outside the US. Yeah, let me give an example so that you can easily understand. Say here, a bank, XYZ bank in the US, invests various amounts in various countries, in various sectors outside the US. So 1 million, 2 million, 3 million, 5 million, 1 million, 3 million. So $15 million investment is made outside the US. Say this is in UK, this is in India, this is in Singapore, this is in somewhere Middle East, UAE, this is in X country, this is in Y country. Okay, XYZ bank invested in outside US in various companies. And here in UK, some amount may be in pharma sector, telecom sector, infrastructure, etc., etc. So different sectors in different countries. US citizen has a facility to invest in these amounts without being exposed to the foreign investments. This $15 million, as far as US bank is concerned, it is the total investment, and each investment is broken into small amount of say $1,000. How many units? 15,000 units. 15,000 units, same like mutual fund. 15,000 units are sold to US citizen CO. Okay, US citizen will get units issued by an American bank which invested outside the US in different sectors. So the value go up, no? This 1 million will go up to some extent, 2 million, 3 million. You know, these amounts are going up. This may go down, this may go up. So overall value, the impact on 15 million will have an impact on the unit value also. 15,000 units are sold in the US to various investors of US citizen. And the amount is invested outside US. So when the value, this 15 million value goes after 1 year to 16 million. Okay. So 16 million divided by how many investments are the units are there? 15. So it may become 1.09 or something. 16 million divided by 15,000. 16 million divided by 15,000 units. So it has gone to 1,066. Whereas last year the investment value was 1,000, now it is 1,066. This is the incremental value the US citizen will enjoy. They don't need to investigate the foreign investment, the risk, return, etc., etc. Simply depend on ADR, American depository receipt.